Hi, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com today with another exciting episode for you. And today I'm here in my backyard shooting a video for you guys actually at 10 o'clock at night. I got lighting on me, so hopefully I'm lit up pretty good. But more importantly, actually I want to show you guys the thermometer behind me there. It's 10 o'clock at night. It's still maybe like 92, 94 degrees. We've been having some killer days here in excess of 110 degrees lately. It's actually quite fun. So I'm either usually out gardening early or really late, and I might go out in the middle of the day just to make sure everything is doing good in my garden. Anyways, today's episode is gonna be try to be one of those quick ones, and I'm gonna see if I can do it today. Today I'm just gonna share with you guys my top 63 organic gardening tips that you will want to follow so that you can grow the most food in a small residential space. And I'm just gonna get into the tips because most of them are self-explanatory, and if I do feel that there are some that are not self-explanatory, I'll maybe stop and put my two cents in. But my goal is to have this video less than 10 minutes, which is gonna be, I think, a world's record for me in itself. All right, so we got the tips in different categories. So this is like, first is general tips. Number one, start a garden today, or start some new seeds and cuttings today if you already have an established garden. Very important. You know, you want to get growing if you haven't already. Number two, grow in raised beds. I love raised beds. They're definitely the way to go. You can control the soil. Focus on building and feeding your soil, not growing your vegetables or your fruit trees, right? The soil is literally the health of your plants. The better quality the soil you have, the healthier your plants will be, and the more productive they're going to be in the end. All right. Number four, create a habitat for you and other creatures would like to live in. That's very important, right? Have your garden a nice place for you, but also for the creatures that inhabit the earth around us, right? There are many beneficial insects that will be glad to live in your space if you allow them to and you provide them a good home. I have like little lizards running around, and I have like praying mantises this year. Value other creatures on the planet and positively identify creatures before taking any action. You know, it's unfortunate that we're all scared of bugs in this day and age. And if you see a bug, you think it's a bad bug automatically. Oh, there's a spider in my house. If you're like my brother, like, it's gonna bite me. It's a black widow. I'm gonna die, right? Bugs and insects and other creatures on the planet are not always bad. So please make sure you do a positive identification and find out what they are before you take any kind of action to exterminate them out of your garden. Number six is grow microgreens indoors. Super critical, super important. You want to grow these microgreens and other sprouts indoors year round so that you could be eating even when it's off season. So just wanted to take a moment out of this episode today to remind you guys that we're still doing, for a limited time, the Growing Your Greens t-shirt fundraiser. So if you want to support me and my work, you could definitely buy a Growing Your Greens t-shirt that directly supports me to allow me to continue to make my educational videos. Plus, you definitely get a really cool organic cotton Growing Your Greens t-shirt. So yeah, check the link down below, compassiontees.com. Link is also at the end of this video. So when you're done watching the video, click over and support me while you still can, and also get a cool organic t-shirt at the same time. Number seven, compost all your food scraps and garden waste to create compost you could add to your garden, but also reduce the waste load in the industrial waste system that is not working. Eight, don't use chemical fertilizers or non-organic sprays in your garden. They can wreak havoc on soil ecology. You know, even one spray of Roundup in the areas around your garden beds is really bad. That can negatively impact the soil microbes, even if it's not directly on or in your garden bed. So I encourage you guys not to use any kind of synthetic chemical fertilizers or pesticides. Nine, save seeds and regrow them each year. Self-explanatory, so important to save your seeds. You're creating your own genetics that are gonna do good in your area. Number 10, share your seeds with others. Very important, share your seeds with other people in your local area so we can, you know, create the diversity. Number 11, use no-till gardening methods. Increase soil biology that will aerate your soil and sell your tiller. This is super critical, man. The future of farming is no-till farming that increases carbon in the soil, also increases fertility. So you don't have to keep adding as much fertilizer every year. Number 12, use reusable plant ties in your garden instead of single use. That's very important. We want to reduce the amount of waste. I have many different plant ties. Maybe I'll make another video about it one of these days. You can grow in the shade. find herbs and leafy greens that will thrive. I know we all have different, you know, areas of our garden, some in full sun, some in part shade, some in really good shade, and you just gotta find the plant that will grow there. 14, check to make sure it's legal or you're allowed to grow food wherever you're putting in a garden. This is especially true if you have an HOA or some cities may not allow you to put in a garden. It's quite unfortunate. Number 15, continue your gardening education every day. This is super critical. You've never learned it all. I still don't know it all. I'm learning and growing every day by reading, by visiting places and learning from people. And you guys could read, learn from people, and also experiment on your own. I'm also running many experiments in my garden. And also, of course, make sure you hit that subscribe button right below, down below, and hit the bell so you get notified of my new and upcoming videos. I have more diverse gardening information than anybody on YouTube that I'm aware of, in my opinion. All right. 16, spend time improving your garden every day. You know, what you put your time into will become better. If you just ignore your garden, it's not gonna work out in most cases. So spend some time each and every day to make it better. 17, keep a collection of reused 5-gallon buckets in your garden. You can get these at sometimes grocery stores or delis or just throwing these buckets away. I have those all over my garden. They're super useful for carrying compost around, you know, doing clippings, harvesting, all kinds of stuff. And 18, general tip is have fun. Super important, man. If you're not having fun, you're not gonna be a successful gardener. All right, next I wanna get into some techniques on maybe things specifically to do. Techniques is number one, walk your whole garden once or twice a day to keep tabs on everything. You know, if you have a job, you have to go out to work every day, walk it in the morning before you go to work. That's also a good de-stressor. And also walk it at night once you get home from work. It's a good de-stressor also to see what's going on, how the plants are looking, if they're looking wilted, if they got bugs on them, and then take appropriate action. Number two, grow up all vertical spaces in your yard. You know, whether you have fencing around, you could grow up walls of your house by putting up trellis paneling against that so that you could maximize your vertical growing spaces. Of course, also grow vertically in your garden with trellis and different, cages. Number three, put up a greenhouse or hoop house to extend your growing season. This is very important. Even though I live in a year-round growing season, I have greenhouses behind me that allows me to grow plants that I wouldn't be able to grow otherwise in the winter because it does get too cold. Number four, start growing early in the season and then late in the season by covering your beds, whether you're going to use some hoop houses, some covers, grow in raised beds that, increase the temperature a little bit. You're going to get bigger harvests. Number five, experiment with 20 to 25% new varieties of vegetables and fruit trees and herbs and plants every year. You know, you got your good old standby, 75% of your garden, you know it's going to work, you know you're going to get stuff. But part of the fun of gardening is experimenting, so always try some new different seed packets and some new varieties because they may outperform your old ones and or they may taste better. Number six, bricks test your harvest to see how you can improve the quality of the food you grow. This is very important. Check my links down below. I have links to a lot of the topics I talk about in this video just as a quick one-liner, but I have in-depth 1 hour or half hour videos about all these topics. Number seven, visit local gardens, farms, and other gardeners to find out what works and what doesn't work in your specific area. You know, this is research I do before I started a garden here. I found out what other people were growing and I just duplicated and saw what they did and then started to modify and change my approach once I got a good solid foundation. All right. Number eight, pull out diseased and dead plants as soon as possible, right? And replace them with healthy plants. You know, I got a few things that didn't make it in the hot weather here, and I'm just gonna pull it out, get rid of it, because disease and dead plants could attract disease and problems in your garden. And plus also, it's not good for your psyche. You're like, oh man, I killed some stuff. Well, you didn't kill it. Anyways, that's another topic. But replace them so that you could see all green and you'd be like, yeah, look, I'm a success. And so I always have backup plants ready to go. All right, number nine, when you have a failure, ask yourself, how can you do better next time? Instead of like, oh, I'm a failure, I'm just gonna give up, right? Yeah, okay, so my melons didn't make it this year, I failed, why? Well, I'll have another video on that, but you know, I'm gonna do it better next time, it's all right. So I'm learning. Okay, next area we're gonna talk about is the soil. Tip number one is source the best compost in your area for garden beds and do pot testing before you buy any large quantities. This is super important. Pot testing is you're gonna buy like a little bit of each kind of soil around you that you could get, and grow the same plant in all the pots and see which pot grows the best of that kind of plant. And then you're gonna probably get that soil because that soil is probably gonna do better on other similar plants. Number two, add fungal dominated compost to your garden beds. This is super critical. If you go down to Lowe's, Home Depot, even most landscape nurseries, they're not gonna have fungal dominated compost, and they're gonna look at you like you're an alien from Mars, because they're not gonna know what the heck you're talking about. So watch my videos for fungal dominated compost. Number three, use rock dust in your garden beds for the trace minerals. Super critical, super important. You know, the soils are devoid of minerals due to leaching and all erosion and all these things. And I believe that, you know, the rock dust makes significant difference. I also have videos on all these topics. Number four, add a good quality worm casting to your garden beds, or make your own, and not all worm castings are created equal. So be aware of that and check my other videos on worm castings for more info. Number five, use seaweed and seaweed extracts in your garden for better plant growth. You know, they have a lot of different auxins and all these different components in there, as well as some of the trace minerals that may not be in other fertilizers that can really help your plants thrive. Number six, cover your soil with mulch. And I prefer actually a living mulch, so growing, you know, low growing plants down below my intended plants. So in my pepper bed here, I have actually some purslane that's growing down below. Of course, you can use other kind of mulches as well. Last year I used plastic mulch, which actually worked pretty good. Seven, add beneficial bacteria and fungi to your garden, whether you want to inoculate with, you know, ones that come in a capsule, or, you know, in a powder, or make your IMOs. You know, we need to get these guys in your garden. I like to supplement them. I have other videos on it. Number eight, use insect frass in your gardening mix. This is very important. There's many different kinds of insect frass that you guys will be learning out real soon. I got some good upcoming episodes coming out, but they're really critical. And in nature, there would be insect frass in soils, maybe not in the high amounts that we would like to add to the garden, but they would be in there. And this is something I think that is missing in big ways, actually, because of the biology in the frass. Number nine, add biochar to your garden. This is important, by adding up to 20% to your compost pile. So don't add the biochar right into your garden beds. Add it to your compost pile up to 20%. And as your compost is being made, it'll incorporate that biochar, get the biochar charged, structured, living, whatever you want to call it, so that when you do use it, it's up and ready to go and you're going to get the benefits, all right? The next area we're going to talk about is adding fertility to your garden. Number one, make and use compost tea every week or two. I like to use Boogie Brew compost tea because it's a ready-made product that I know is really good, so I don't have to like worry about like mixing and all these things. But hey, if you want to mix your own, great. Try to source some of the best ingredients. Make sure you check the open source compost tea recipe I did. Number two, foil or feed sea minerals once or twice a month, and make sure they are properly diluted. Some sea minerals may be high in sodium that can damage your plants, actually. Number three, pee in your garden. Yes, I said pee in your garden. pee is actually nature's most nitrogen-rich fertilizer. Although some of you guys may have to dilute it. I'm like so hydrated, I just pee straight under my plants, trees preferably, never my leafy greens, to give them nutrition. Don't flush it using clean water. It's a real big waste. Next section we're gonna talk about are the plants, selecting the right plants, all the kind of plants that you guys wanna grow. This section is super critical for your success, and it's not any one of these sections is important. They're all important. You need to combine all these different tips and techniques to have a successful garden. Number one is grow high value crops. You know, most of my garden is not tomatoes, it's peppers, because peppers, if you go to the store, they sell for $4.99, $5.99 a pound. I think I've seen them for $9.99 a pound if you're, you know, unlucky enough to live in South Florida, for organic, right? Instead of tomatoes, which generally are a lot less expensive, maybe $2 a pound. So grow the high value crops. Maybe to you, high value crops are anti-cancer crops, you know, like the ashwagandha, or like some of the longevity spinach, or the moringa, you know, some of these special plants that have different phytonutrients that may help you on your journey in life, you know, that you literally money can't buy. Number two, grow leafy greens. My channel is called Growing Your Greens, and the greens are the most nutrient dense foods on the planet and the most under-eaten food on the entire planet as well, in my opinion. Number three, grow the herbs. Aside from the leafy greens, the herbs are super nutritious, probably have more antioxidant power than actually the leafy greens. I want you guys to grow those, and also herbs tend to be very easy to grow and you know, are quite potent, so you don't really need to even use a lot of them. Number four, plant crops that are proven in your area, very important, right? If you're in the summer, in the desert, right? Certain crops that like it really moist, like katuk. Katuk doesn't grow well here because it's too dry. It needs to be really nice and humid. So yeah, grow the plants, they're gonna do good in your area. How will you know? Go visit the farms. I talked about this earlier. Visit other gardeners. Find out what, you know, the master gardeners are recommending to people in your area. Number five, plant the crops at the right time of year, right? If I planted this moringa here in October, that would not be good because soon before, right when it got down to 50 degrees, that guy would be gone. So I planted it, you know, in the summertime when it's nice and hot, and look at it, 100 plus degree weather, nice and green and thriving. All right. Number six, ensure plants have the proper microclimate. Very important. Some plants don't like too much sun. They might like to be under the shade of some plants or whatnot. You know, you have areas in your garden where it's near the house, near the fence, or in full sun. So plant the plants in the right location. If you don't know, try plants in every different locations one year and then find out which one does better so that next year you'll be fully versed on where you're going to put your plants, right? Grow a variety of edible foods, right? Don't just only grow leafy greens. Don't just only grow tomatoes. Try to grow like a variety of things, you know, trees, vegetable, herbs. And the more varieties of things you grow and kinds of foods you grow, the more success you'll have, right? Because you'll find that some plants will just do better than others. Let's see, number eight, grow a good percentage of perennial vegetables that grow year-round or come back on their own every year. That's very important. This will reduce your workload and you'll always have food available. Tree collards are my favorite that just grow year-round. I've also been able to pretty much grow year-round the longevity spinach or Gynera procumbens by covering them in the winter. My Egyptian walking onions come back every year. I always have some kind of onions growing in my garden, as well as some of the different herbs, the rosemary and the sage. They grow year-round, as does the mint. Let's see. Number nine, grow a percentage of wild foods and edible weeds. And the reason for that is because they are bothered less by pets. So if you, by pests, not pets. And they're easier to grow because there are weeds, literally dandelions. I got them sprouting up in just random places in my garden, right? And they're a joy because I don't really have to do anything. They just come up. Sometimes I have too many, so I actually pull them out and then I'll eat them or cook or, you know, juice them or whatever. So grow some of those guys because they're also very nutritious for you and, of course, easy to grow. Number 10, plant transplants or seeds at systematic spacing to avoid wasted space. I literally get out a ruler and measure out, you know, the distance between all my pepper plants, which this year I have a video on that. It's probably like about 11 inches, 10 and a half, 11 inches in between my plants. So I could really maximize the space. So once they grow up and fill out, it's pretty much covering the whole bed and I don't have any wasted space in my beds. So the next area has to do with pests in your garden. Number one, you wanna pick off bad bugs or spray with high pressure water before you do even any organic sprays, right? Picking things off with your fingers, you know, or spraying off with high pressure water is basically like not gonna hurt any beneficials. Even if you spray neem oil and Dr. Bronner soap, you know, as organic as it is, it may negatively affect beneficial insects in your garden. So I've been trying not to spray anything actually this year. Of course, having higher quality, you know, nutrients in your soil will produce plants that are healthier. They're gonna have a bigger immune system and stronger immune system to resist bug attacks, all right? And number two, grow plants that are resistant to pests, right? Some plants really don't get any bugs. And some plants get a lot of bugs. You know, the brassica family plants tend to get a lot of aphids in my garden. And, you know, the water spinach, I don't think I've ever seen an aphid on there. So, next area I want to talk about is beneficial insects. This is very important to my biologic organic gardening style, where I'm not just using organic approved products. I'm trying to create a whole system in my backyard of beneficials and bad bugs, and if the bad bugs are there, the good bugs will come and eat them because I've either seeded them and put them in, or they're you know, just gonna be attracted to my garden. So number one, attract pollinators to your garden by planting flowers, natives, and leaving bare ground and putting up mason bees homes. This is very important, as you guys learned in a couple of the episodes right before this one. Number two, attract beneficial insects to your garden by planting attractant plants. There's beneficial insects that like certain plants. I also have a video on this. You guys wanna plant some of those plants. And number three, release beneficial insects but not ladybugs in your garden. Ladybugs pretty much fly away in my opinion, but there's other beneficials that will stick around provided they have a food source. They'll lay eggs in your garden, then they'll basically come back year after year for you to do your dirty work. Number four, optimally, don't keep a worm bin, right? Keep the worms in your garden beds and feed your garden beds appropriately. After every season, I top off my beds with compost, earthworm castings, rock dust, and kelp and different things. And so if I do have earthworms in there, they're basically just feeding on the new material I'm putting in. Plus, I leave my roots after every season cut. I cut them at the base and leave the roots in the ground to basically decay and also feed my worms. Next, I want to talk about watering, right? Number one, harvest rainwater and filter it as needed to water your plants. If it's legal where you live, actually some places, I think it's a crime. It's illegal. Number two, install a water efficient irrigation system that you put on an automatic timer. If I didn't have an irrigation system on an automatic timer, my whole garden in 100 plus degree weather would not be alive right now because I'm not here to water, you know, a couple hours. So a drip irrigation is fine, or I have the aquajet irrigation on this side of my yard. Have videos on it, of course. Number three, water each plant enough, not too much and not too little. And every plant has different water requirements. Some like it on the dry side, some like it on the more wet side, but you guys need to learn where that is for each of your individual plants so they can thrive. Number four, filter your city water. If you're using city water to water your garden, filter your water to remove the chlorine that may negatively affect your beneficial microbes in your garden that you worked hard to get in there in the first place, all right? Last section we're gonna talk about today is using your harvest. You've grown all this amazing food. What do you do with it? How do you get it into use so you guys can get the benefits of the food you grew? Number one, go out to your garden before every meal to harvest out of your garden and what you're gonna eat and build your meals around foods you just harvested. And then if you don't have all the ingredients you need, fill in with inferior foods that you actually bought from the grocery store. And I would encourage you guys to use whole food products, not processed foods that are fractionated and all this kind of stuff. That's a whole other topic. Number two, I would encourage you guys to juice your vegetables. I will give a disclaimer. I do sell juicers for a living at discountjuicers.com. But I think juicing your vegetables and your other fruits and vegetables are one of the best ways to get them in you because literally it creates some pulp that you could then compost or feed to your worms. But you're getting literally the lifeblood of the plants into you that is in a more digestible and easier digestible state when you're making juice out of it. I mean, I could also say, you know, vacuum blend more of your vegetables, you know, to make smoothies and green smoothies if you need to do that. But I actually prefer juicing a little bit more, especially when you have such an abundance of fruits and vegetables to use. You're gonna get more benefits in my opinion. And number three, ferment your vegetables so you can increase certain nutrients and increase storage time. You know, just yesterday, or, you know, I was actually eating kimchi that I grew from the winter time, you know, half a year ago, but it's fermented sitting on the counter, not even under refrigeration, that I was enjoying last night. So I got my winter greens in me in the summertime. And then finally, preserve your harvest, right? My favorite way to preserve my harvest now, and I'll have videos upcoming on this, is freeze drying. I got a freeze dryer. It's actually running right now with some cactus fruits in there. But freeze drying is the best way that I found to preserve my harvest. I'll have a link down below if you want to learn more about the freeze drying technology, and or you could just wait for my videos. It's simply amazing. So that's pretty much it today. Hopefully this video at least will come in under 20 minutes for you guys. I know I've talked a lot, but I've conveyed hopefully a lot of information without a lot of rhetoric or nonsense like I normally talk. Anyways, if you guys enjoyed this episode, hey, please be sure to give me a thumbs up. I'll try to do more in-depth, right to the point videos without getting too much into the extra stuff, although I really like the extra stuff because you get kind of really get the background and the knowledge. But if you guys want the extra stuff, check my other videos. I have plenty of those out there, over 1,400 videos now, which is amazing. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below and make sure you click the bell to be notified when my new and upcoming videos come out every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And be sure to check out past episodes. I put a couple links down below in the description to some of the videos that I maybe referenced in this episode so that you guys could learn more in detail about some of the topics that I've discussed with you guys today. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.